Coleman, can you tell us where you were born?
Well, you see, I've been explaining to people for years and years how my mother and father used to travel an awful lot, you know. So, and the truth of my birthplace was never actually out because I was born at sea, you understand? But I'm supposed to have been born in St. Joseph, Missouri.
St. Joseph, Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
I see where.
On the Atlantic Ocean. You know, on a boat. Uh-huh. See what I mean? Then it's hard to say actually where my real birthplace would be there, isn't it? You know?
How did that happen? Were your folks traveling to Europe?
They were coming back.
Were they in children?
Huh? No.
No.
Mm-hmm. But,
any times?
My father could play one piece. He had one little piece that he made up on the piano, but. Very elementary, though. I picked it up when I was about 5 years old.
And your mother play any instruments?
Mom used to play the organ at church. Then she played piano.
You have any brothers and sisters?
No. I had a sister that was 2 years and 8 months old when she died. I was before I was born.
Were you brought up in St. Joe, Missouri?
Mm-hmm.
You go to school there?
Yeah, well, you know, not really. But I mean, I didn't go to school. I went to school there very early, you know. But then I went over to Kansas and went to school. Went to school out to Topeka and out to Washburn, you know. And then I went to Chicago and went to school. But my schooling around St. Joe was very short.
When did you first come into contact with any kind of music?
Oh, well, you see, I practically started out with music. Like, you know, I started on the piano when I was only 5 or 6 years old, that's all. And then I was always interested in music. And then I stayed around it. I used to find a lot of different friends. They all was playing too, you know what I mean? And so when I went to school, I continued music all the time, and I played in all the school orchestras, and, you know, I used to have to transpose cello parts on the tenor.
on the tenor, when did you give up piano?
Oh, I never did give up the piano, but I got a tenor for my 9th birthday, and I started playing it. And then,
Sorry, when you were 9, a tenor was not exactly a widespread instrument, was it?
Oh, it was being used. Yeah, it was being used quite a lot. They couldn't play too much on it, but it was plenty of them being played, yeah. But it seemed like they didn't play jazz like I did, you know? I just had a natural feeling for it on the tenor, I guess.
But you did hear jazz when you were a kid.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
What kind of jazz was
around? Oh. I don't know. There were several different kinds. Like, you could hear there was a lot of people that could execute well and play over their instruments and tongue their instruments and, as a matter of fact, play them quite right, you know? And there were a lot of people that used to make a lot of noises. The funnier noise you could make, the better it was, you know, and things like that. Like trumpet players used to carry around buckets and things, make odd sounds.
Was the first jazz you heard in St. Joe?
The first jazz I heard, yes. Yeah, well, that was when I was just a little kid. Yeah, I heard jazz right then. These places like down 2nd Street, where it used to be less like the real Tenderloin neighborhood, more or less, and that's where they used to have the jazz bands playing all night and all that, you know. Because I didn't get a chance to hear much of that, but I used to hear a lot of records. I used to hear a lot of records, and I used to hear all the jazz people that would come to the theater there called the Lyceum. And everybody that came through there, like all variety, played the Lyceum.
Can you think of the first... or any of the records that you can remember from those days, or of any individual guy that you thought was good?
The ones I know of is people like Louis Armstrong and Buster Bailey and Joe Oliver and people like that, yes. See, well, I heard them. I heard them, and let me see, first time, I think, in Chicago. I was going to school. That's when I heard them first.
How old were you when you first went to Chicago?
Oh, I was really young. That's around, I was around 12, around that age.
Did you think even then that you were going to play a horn for a living?
I never thought about it in that way, but I knew I was going to play the horn because I was already playing it. But I never thought about it commercially, really. Actually, I had played already commercially by the time I was 12. Well, I played for like schools. When I was going out to school, they'd have dances and things like that. I played all those. All the other kids dancing, they were big kids way up in high school or out of high school or getting ready to go to college or something, you know what I mean? And they were the ones doing the dancing, but I was playing. Because I was as big as I am now when I was 12. I think I stopped growing when I was about 12. I don't remember getting any taller.
What kind of a band was it that you played in when you played the school dances?
These early ones we used to play, used to use a piano, drums, and myself. Yeah, once I had, there was one boy that I played with out in Topeka. He couldn't play anything but F sharp. Every piece he played was in F sharp. So I had to learn how to play in my G sharp on the tenor. They put me in G sharp, you know, and I had to just learn how to play every piece in G sharp. That was good for me, though, I guess. That gave me an early start on transposition, you know. I needed that. That helped me out later on when I was studying transposition and composition and all that stuff when I was going to school. I mean, you know, made it not too difficult for me. I knew what it was.
Did you notice anything special when you went to Chicago? Did you notice right away that there was a difference, was more jazz or better jazz, or did it just all seem the same?
It seemed, I don't think I heard anything too much, too new to what I knew already, actually. I think I knew most of this at that time, you know? I guess I'd, practically the same as what I'd been listening to, you know? Because you heard the same kind of jazz in Kansas City.
Had you been there before you went to Chicago? Oh,
I'd been over to Kansas City. See, Kansas City was only about 50 miles from St. Joe. And I had been in Kansas City for, you know, visit like 2 or 3 days or weekend and things like that.
Remember who some of the people were in Kansas City, you heard?
I remember there used to be a little boy in Kansas City, and he was also in Chicago. But I think he originally came from Kansas City. A little boy named Stump Evans used to play tenor and clarinet. Yeah, I remember Stump. I wouldn't know what he looked like now, but I remember Stump Evans at that time. He played quite well, too.
Well, when you were a kid, did you hear much ragtime piano in St. Louis and that area?
I used to hear piano every place.
Ragtime piano? Or was it blues piano?
It was more like boogie woogie, I guess. Mixed up, kind of mixed up, very good.
What was the pattern of jobs in those days? I mean, I'm still talking about when you were a wee kid.
Yeah.
Mostly in bars.
No, it wasn't like it is today. These things about bars happened. They started. I think they perhaps started. More or less back in the 30s, you know? But before then, I don't know, music seemed like, I guess it was perhaps a little bit, a little higher plane. And music was in conservative way of saying chamber music. I mean, you'd play in people's living rooms. They'd have, there's places that you'd play, you know what I mean? And unless you were playing for a dance, then if you played for a dance, it would be in a dance hall, you know.
You'd play jazz in people's living rooms?
Oh, sure. Yeah, we used to play in people's houses and things. You never played in a bar.
If you were going to be a working musician in those days, what would be the best possible job you think you might have been able to get?
What you would have done is play theaters. See, it was a big demand for that in theaters. And I mean, you worked 52 weeks every year.
With every show that came.
You just go around with your show. You'd have a, I just wasn't old enough to be on my own, you know. But if I mean that would have been the thing, like have a 5 or 6 piece band, and just do the Keith circuit. You get in properly with these people, and you couldn't help but make a hit, you know, because that was the biggest thing there was.
Oh, it wasn't in the pit. It was just featured act.
No. They had pit orchestras, but it was just some straight musicians. They didn't mean nothing. All they could do is read music.
What kind of money would you get on those jobs in those days?
Oh, well, I tell you, the better you, of course, I said the better you were, the more you could make, you know. But now you could make $75 a week. Much as that, you make $100 a week, $100 and a quarter, which was a big salary. It was a very good salary. And believe it or not, you could buy a car and home with that salary. Because there's plenty of them who have done it and did it. But, like I say, but it was possible you could make that kind of money.
What kind of admissions did they get?
Don't remember exactly. We used to go in Topeka, we'd come in after school, you know. We used to go to this theater every week, didn't miss a week. It's hard for me to remember exactly. I know the movie houses were about, what was the movie houses, about 10 cents or something like that.
Okay, for that you get like 7 or 8 acts of all different kinds.
Well, I think it would run a little more than in the variety houses, I think, you know. Maybe perhaps a quarter.
Did the Variety House also have a movie?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What other acts, what other, can you name some of the people that would be on the bill along with the jazz band?
I mean, I can name you people that were headline acts at that time. People like, people like Sophie Tucker and Van Skank and Ted Lewis. Ted Lewis was one of those kind of bands, you know. And he was well liked. I know I would never miss. He came in, I'd always go to hear it because I thought that was fine.
I'm interested. Would you
Want
Negro performers appear on the same bills
in those days as white performers? You mean, did they have mixed organizations? Let me see. I don't know that I ever saw a mixed organization. Commercially, I don't think. I don't think they were doing that then. No. Because they weren't. Let me see. Like, around here, Safe Morrison's in the around 35. When I first went to Europe, we used to play together. But I think that's before they actually had the organizations mixed. Because I mean, I was we used to always be playing together, but it was always our jam sessions and things like that. But like Jack Teagarden and those boys would be playing with us. That night, Jack would be playing with an all-white organization, you know what I mean? And I'd be back playing with Fletcher, and that's what it was, you know? But it was sometime around in the 30s, the latter part of the 30s or something, when this business got, when they started it.
Did you Did you ever see any of the very, very early blues singers?
Yeah, I saw, I saw Mamie Smith, and I've seen Bessie Smith and Clara Smith.
Well, that's a little later. That's not when you were a youngster.
You mean before yeah, Mamie? I didn't see anything before Mamie. I was a kid when I worked with Mamie. I worked with Mamie with the time I had with Mamie, I had what do you call it? Something have to go around with you, a guardian.
Do you think generally in the days when you were first becoming a real professional musician that most of the people that you worked with worked harder at proper execution of the horn and so forth than they do now?
No. No, not the ones that I worked with. Mm-hmm. Not the ones I work with now. You know, I think the fellas now work harder at it. Yeah, they're much better executionists.
But how come you became such a remarkable...
One reason why was because I was never satisfied. Like, when I was playing one note, because I couldn't play with one note. I wasn't playing that one note because I wanted to. I played that one note because I just couldn't get off of it. That's the best I could do. But I got so I could make two, I made two. You know, like that. That's the way it's always been with me.
But the thing is that in those days, there was nobody really around playing a sax which could influence you in your style. You had to develop it yourself.
That's true. But here's what it was. In that part, I'm still the very same. I don't listen to any particular thing, any particular instrument, to get a style from or get an idea from. I mean, I just soon listen to piano players. I can get just as much from a piano player, especially if it's the right ones, you know what I mean? And I hear a lot of things that they make that I like, and I'll try to make that on my horn, that's all, you know? Because, goodness. You start going around just listening to a horn. Suppose you had ideas about being a good horn player and you get someplace around or during a certain area or period and they're playing something that you really don't, it doesn't mean anything too much to you and you got to listen to that. If you got to take that as a criterion, you're in a bad shape. So if you find yourself, you'd be playing the same thing, you know? Now, and things like that, you got to go get some violin players or something. Let them play for you.
Can you think of anybody just offhand who in the early days sounded to you like they had the right idea? Not so much that maybe they were the greatest, but they just seemed like they were on the right track to you.
And the ways they used to play? Well, I used to like a lot of things. For one thing, I used to like several clarinet players I used to like. You know? Well, Buster Bailey. I liked Buster Bailey, and one reason I liked Buster Bailey because he was fingering that clarinet. I liked that. That appealed to me. You know.
You know Buster before the Henderson days.
Let me see. I don't think I ever met Buster. No, I never met Buster. But Buster was playing in Chicago. Buster was playing in Chicago when I was going to school in Chicago. Yeah, Buster was playing in Chicago. So was Louis.
This is about when? About 1924?
Well, as early as I can possibly figure it could be. It would have to be around, perhaps around 25. That's the earliest I can figure it. And I only knew Fletcher a short time before then. I'd made a few records with him. And then finally he added a few more pieces to the combination he was using for the recordings, you know, it was sort of quite a bit like they do today, you know, you get together, he had a certain bunch he'd pick out to go down and make these record dates, you know, and then he finally organized more or less and got this bunch together and he went into Roseland. I know I can remember that because he went down there on an audition. I think it was about six men showed up for the audition. Well, he left up on the job. I guess they had nobody else in mind. That's about what it was. I know it was about six down there because I wasn't even there myself.
Was Fletcher Henderson the first big band you ever played with?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the first.
How did you happen to go with him? From the
well... Yeah, I finished up in New York, and I'd pick up my horn, say, for instance, and one of these older musicians that had these, what they call gigs, you know, what I call myself doing right today. That's all I do, is gig most of the time, you know. And in other words, today you call them one-nighters, and they've got some other nice names fixed up for them, you know what I mean? But they're some gigs to me. And, but that's all I was doing, you know. And there was several spots around where we used to go in at night, and beside the, what you call it today, jam, we used to call them cutting contests. Like I hear about maybe a tenor player is playing down there, you know what I mean? Well, I have to go down and cut him, you know? So, well, they used to come and get me. You know, a lot of times they'd come and find me, like some boy would come around, they didn't know anything about him, and he's was playing more than the majority of them, you know, and all that, you know, and they'd come up the house and get me, you know, and I had to go down to cut this boy. That was the exact expression, too. Mean, you got to come down and cut this cat, man. He's a smart cat. He's kind of smart down there, you know. That's the way they talked. And, and that's how Fletcher and his henchmen, that's how they happened to hear me play, you know. So right away they came over and asked me would I join them, and or would I do some records with them, you know. So this wasn't with any of the blues singers. Like, I never did any of those things. Like, you know, Fletcher had a lot of things he did on the Black Swan records. I never did any of those. I never got in on those. I don't think Fletcher did. I don't know if he did any more of those or not at that time. But we used to make vocalions and Columbias. That's what I did with him. Then he finally got the band together and went into Roseland. And constantly recording, you know. And that's how he made a hit. We used to play so much music, we used to call it, it's more like stomping or something. You know what I mean? It was a little more heavier jazz than anybody else seemed to be playing to me, you know?
When Fletcher called you to hire you for the band, were you...
You know,
when Fletcher called you to hire you for the band, were you did you think this was a big opportunity, or was it just another job to you?
Just another job. No, at that time Fletcher didn't have any particular lot of reputation at all. I mean, Fletcher had been playing accompaniment for these blues singers and things, you know. Like, I tell you what, Ethel Waters. Let's just play for Ethel Waters all the time. And, you know, these Black Swan records with Ethel Waters. So, but I went with him because I used to love to play.
When you first went into the band, did you have a fair-sized book that you had to learn right away?
Well, what he had was these arrangements and things that he was getting, they had gotten together already through making the records. He had those numbers, and then he had Don Redman, and you know Don Redman was quite a writer, and I guess he still is, you know what I mean? You know Don Redman, of course. Well, Don Redman was the arranger, and Fletcher had him. He was playing in the band, and he knew the band, he knew how to write for it and everything, you know, so Don used to be constantly making arrangements for the band. So the first thing you know, Fletcher's book started getting larger and larger, you know. And as a matter of fact, I always more or less thought Fletcher's actual band style changed when it shouldn't have. You know, I've always said that too.
In what way?
Well, I think Fletcher's band should have stayed stomping. I think it should have always been a stomp band. I think they should have stomped all bands out of existence until the very end. I think he should have never stopped. But Fletcher's band started to get into Got too sophisticated. Before it was like, you know how you make a comparison with certain types of music and folk music, you know. Well, you'd be surprised how actually commercial and how well liked folk music is, you know. You can't get away from it. And don't think for a minute that it's easy, because it isn't. And as musical as it can be, if you don't believe it, you just listen to anybody's folk music. You listen to any of these supposedly great old writers and things like that, and even the contemporaries and anything. And you see that the folk music, you perhaps think of it as being something from the earth, you know what I mean? It's earth music, you know? And right away you'll say to yourself, well, that means it's got to be elementary or something, but it isn't. That music is some of the hardest that there is to play. You don't believe it. You just get some of that stuff of Smetana's, any of those fellas, and start fooling with it. See what happens. Get some of that Hungarian stuff or some of that Romanian music. Try to play it. It's bad. See, I used to play all this stuff when I was going to school, you know. I came up pretty right with music, you know. Had a good, pretty good background. I got a chance to hear every kind of everything, you know. I think that's good for you. Gives you a better appreciation. I always did say, I thought Fletcher's band should have, just as the way they used to, that sound it used to have, you know, and it was like the King Porter Stomp thing, you know. We had a lot of pieces like that, you know. Those pieces were all heads, that's all. They were written down. They never did sound the same, even written. But I know Fletcher wrote it for Goodman, and he wrote it for several people, but he never wrote that to make it sound like we used to play it, because nobody else ever sounded that way with it. And mind you, I'm gonna tell you something else about Fletcher's band. If you ever heard it in person, and you heard the King Porter Stomp, then if you ever heard, I know you've heard the record, Fletcher's record of it. Well, that record was 100% as good as what that band sound in the Roseland playing King Porter Stomp. We used to rock those walls in there. The place would shake when we played the thing. It was, you know, it was full, and I don't know, it had something else that they never were able to record. You know, Fletcher's band never recorded good, you know that, don't you? Now, we didn't have a chance with Duke on records, but Duke didn't have a chance with us in person. No, we played against each other gangs and gangs of times, you know. He'd blow Duke out. We give Duke a fit in the hall. Because, you see, I don't know, it was a little more, I think it was more, just like I say, it was more stompish. We could out-stomp him, that's all, you know. But he could record so much better.
They once asked five musicians, I can't remember who they were, the greatest moment they could think of in music. And I think four out of the five mentioned different nights when they heard Fletcher's band.
Mm-hmm. But let me tell you something, though. Do you know Fletcher's band is about the only band that's like that, though? Fletcher's band is the only band. See, Fletcher had a completely, I mean, his band is just a complete turnaround to what 99% of bands are. Or you might say 100% of them are. The majority of them sound 100% better on the record than they do in person. Way better on the record, because on the records they record them and you can hear every part. You can hear the saxophone section, you can hear the brass, you can hear the rhythm, you can hear everything, and they balance it up and it's beautiful. And I go to hear them in person, and half the times I can't hear nothing. I can't make out what it is at all. And I say, well, what in the world is this? How do they sound so good on records? And I come in here, I can't hear anything. Like a lot of these instrumentalists. I know a whole lot of instrumentalists that are making recordings, and a lot of saxophone players, as a matter of fact. They make records, and I hear that. And they'll have the band behind them, accompaniment and all that. And they just as loud, they come over this record, you turn the record on, and you can hear every note they're making. You go in a place where they're playing in person, I can't even hear them. Can't hear them. I call that tasting, whispering horn, you know. Well, I mean, you can't hear him at all. Now, you see what the record's done for him? Fletcher's band was just the opposite. The records sound terrible. Sound like cats and dogs just fighting. I mean, no kidding. I've listened to Fletcher's records. This is the funniest sound of things I've ever heard in my life.
Well, you mentioned King Porter. Of course, on a record, it's anywhere from 2.5 to 3 minutes long. How long on a good night would you play a tune like King Porter?
Oh, a lot longer than that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I'll tell you one of the things that used to happen. You see, this is some of the things that you can get away with in person that you can't get away with on a record, for one thing. Now, Fletcher's band used to have some of the worst starts that you ever heard of in your life. We'd be starting off, half the band would be looking for the music. Fletcher's patting his foot. All right, let's go. One, two, three, four, like this, you know. You find about six of them. Bent over, man, keep music on the floor like that. Bent over, you know, picking up this music and now this other six or seven or eight fellas, they play it. Now, what's that going to sound like? See, there's an arrangement made for 14 or 15 pieces and seven or eight playing it. You understand what I mean? And that used to happen regularly, you know. All kinds of things like that, but in person, who cares about that? Nobody pays that into mind. You don't hear that part. When we got down to the crisis, or when it got down to the core of the music, I mean, when it's supposed to be sounding good, everybody was together and everybody was playing like mad. And that's what you hear, you see what I mean? And the endings and like that, you know? But the band didn't care, I mean, it was sloppy, you know what I mean? But it had something else. It had a good sound and a good beat and everything, you know what I mean? It lacked a lot of precision, and I think that's why the records looked like they were, you know? Where in Duke's band was loaded with precision, but they didn't have that, couldn't give you that good in-person sound. Maybe sometimes you can get too precise. Maybe you lose something when you get like that, you know? But you certainly don't on records. Now, a good record has to be precise. The better it is, take for instance, you know what? You can say what you want to, but you can play a thing on a record like you write it like it's written. Like if it's written for you and you play it, it'll actually sound better if you can read that and play it perfectly just like it is. It sound better than if you're trying to sing it and play it, because you may be fluffing, you may do make a few bad notes and things like that. So technically, what you've read will actually sound better on the record, not off the record. Now off the record, it sounds bad. It sounds real mechanical and tight and no feeling and everything. But for some unknown reason, those records, they do marvelous things for you.
Do you remember? Guys like Elmer Chambers and Howard Scott when you first joined Fletcher's band?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who else was in the group when you first joined them?
Well, like I said, Buster Bailey. And then, it was shortly after this that Louis came. Matter of fact, wait a minute. Louis came first, then Buster. That's what it was.
Were you aware of any change in the band when Louis joined, or just sound pretty much the same as you?
No, the band's the sound didn't change. But that was during the time when Fletcher was making a slight transformation, though. In other words, he was exchanging arrangements with other bands and getting. Beginning to sound too much like other bands. And like that, he kept on and on and on, and the band, to me, got to the place where it begins to sound like other bands, which is no good, you know that.
What kind of bands did he swap
for? All the big timers, such things as Gene Goldkitz and the Castle Loma bands, and all the big time bands, you know what I mean? at least, you know, back in the days of bands, they were all top big-time bands, strictly. But you wouldn't fool with anything else. But I couldn't see it. No, I couldn't see that at all. Because the only thing that does is makes you sound like we used to play numbers and sound just like the Casanova band at times. Because we had gangs of their arrangements. You know what I mean? And that same thing. When, you see, what it was, for one thing, in this earlier band that he had, you know, he still had, when he had Don Redman, well, Don used to do a lot of this arranging, you know. And Don used to, he could manage, no matter how musically he arranges right today, at that time, Don could make some very good gut bucket arrangements. We used to call him gut bucket. That's another name for rock and roll, actually. Because these were, that's what they were doing. They were rocking and rolling, but they're a little bit more musical, Rock and roll with a little music behind it. That's what I'm trying to say. You know, the feeling, you know. I made a few arrangements for Fletcher. I made arrangements for Fletcher on number Chick Webb. Chick Webb used to play it. I don't know if you ever heard Chick play it or not, at Savoy. Remember Singing in the Rain? I made arrangements on that when it first came out. All the bands were playing it. And I used to listen to it. Every time I turned the radio on, they'd be playing Singing in the Rain, you know. So one afternoon, I was up at the house, and I decided, well, I think I'll make arrangement on it. So I made it. I wrote it up in a couple of days, I guess. Started on it like that day. I think I finished it the next one. And I took it in, and we started playing it, and that's when Jimmy Harrison was still in the band then. And I used to have a part where he used to have to sing in it. I just like the way he sang. Sound like a comedian, sound like Burt Williams or something singing. But I thought it was different, so I'd always, if anything I did, I'd always give Jimmy something he had to sing, you know? The rest of them perhaps didn't see it that way, but I did. But they could see it that way after I did it, though. Then they liked it, you know.
When you joined Fletcher, you came into contact with a lot of
tenor men. Oh, sure.
Who did you think at this time was the good
tenor? Mm-hmm. Chew. Chew was about the best. You know, Chew Berry was the best one around.
But until Chew came along, you really didn't have any competition at all, did you, for the long stretch of 7 years?
Oh, no, there was others just like Chew. I mean, you know, but I thought Chew was a little better. Well, let me see. Oh, I tell you who I used to like. Prince Robinson. You know Prince? Prince is good, played a lot of tenor. Prince, he could swing, yeah. But Chew was quite a bit like Prince. I think Chew had a little more execution than Prince had. I think he was a little faster than Prince at that time. But Prince had the right idea, and he could play. Oh, he used to give me a little trouble. They used to all come in and they'd try to catch me on my bad nights.
Well, after the time you first joined Fletcher's band, you
were
playing mostly around New York, weren't you?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Oh, then we used to, like in the summer, we'd go out and do about 6 weeks, or maybe 8 weeks, and then come right back into Roseland. And then we'd usually go out for about 4 weeks, and I think it was January or something like that, or maybe say around the 15th of January to the middle of February, something like that. We'd stay out and we'd perhaps go out to the Greystone in Detroit or go someplace and play that length of time and come right back in the Roseland and stay till summer, you know. Then we'd go out of the Roseland for the summer and do one-nighters or something, you know, and come right back in September. That's what we did every year. work all the time, 365 days a year. I just never knew what it was not to be doing something, you know.
When did you record with a schedule like that? Mostly late at night?
No. No, we record in daytime. Record in the afternoon. Or, you know, morning, maybe a 10 o'clock date. Like that. And the thing about it is, at this particular time, I'm not sure, but I don't think it, the dates weren't, like the union didn't have, like straight 3 hours was the, like a session. It was exactly 3 hours like it is today, you know. I think these sessions used to last any kind. It was last till you got through, you know.
How about Charlie Johnson? You were around New York a lot at that time.
Charlie Johnson. Oh, I remember Charlie Johnson. He used to play up for Smalls. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think Jimmy Harrison used to play with him. Mm-hmm. You see, there were two or three fellas, Fletcher's band, and used to be like these baseball teams, you know. There was two or three fellas that used to kind of alternate. They'd be there a year or so, and then they would be out and like that, you know. Because I remember Big Green was the same way. I think he made a couple of times with Fletcher, too. The trombone player?
Green always looked like he wanted to get off the stand and call his wife to see if she was home.
I knew about that part, too. Because he did get off the bandstand and call her to see if she's home. Wasn't the question. He looked like he wanted to do it. He used to get off the bandstand, and not only that, he'd just disappear if she wasn't home. He'd leave right from the phone booth. You wouldn't see him anymore. He left us on the road once. We played in a place that I think was, I don't know whether it was Indianapolis or someplace. We was way out west of it, and Green made a call. He made a couple calls. His last call was around 4 o'clock in the morning. No answer. That's as far as he could make it. We're looking for the trombone. There wasn't any trombone. No, he split. Mm-mm. All you had to do, well, I used to rub it in something terrible. I used to be, well, Fletcher asked me to stop doing it down at the Roseland because I messed it up two or three times down there. You see, we'd get through playing and we'd come out on the platform, you know, cool, it's cool there and everything, you know. Well, I'd start this conversation going, you know. I'd start talking about musicians' wives. And things like that. I said, well, I don't know why. This happens with musicians' wives all the time. And I thought this Gomsey Green would be right here. He's a great big guy, too. And I'd be talking loud enough, just loud enough for him to hear. And I started talking about, man, you just can't trust him. And things like this. And all this stuff, you know. He'd listen, you know. Honest to goodness. He'd leave us. Just gradually, he'd leave me, go downstairs, and I tiptoe down behind him, you know, afterwards, you know, and there he is, in the telephone booth. And if he calls up, and like I said, several times it happened, he'd call up and there's no answer. He'd go right straight out. Leave the trombone. Trombone would be right there on the bandstand. He'd leave it. He'd come back. Going out to find her. You find him around, going all over, going to every place, looking for her.
Was he a
there's no question about it. She was out all the time.
Fast forward, made a couple of records. Did he ever play with you for a long time at all?
Fats never played for any length of time with Fletcher, but he used to play. Every now and then, you know. I always thought it was a big mistake. Fletcher should have kept Fletcher. Should have hired him. Been me, I'd have hired him. See, of course, Fletcher had some peculiar circumstances, you know. He was separated from his first wife or divorced him or something, and she was bothering him by the alimony, and so he kept Fletcher in hot water. He was in bad shape all the time, you know. But Fletcher just, more or less, I didn't think he was didn't take advantage of it like he should have. See, like, he used to get Fats used to write him a lot of music, a lot of those things we used to play, and a lot of the things actually that Fletcher wrote for Goodman, like Stealing Apples and all those things, those are all Fats' numbers. Fats wrote all those pieces, you know. But Fats was broke, he didn't have anything. Fletcher gave him $5, $10, and Fats just go home that night and write 3 or 4 pieces out and bring them in, write them out, bring them in, give them to Fletcher the next day. Fletcher didn't make an arrangement on them, we started playing them. The first thing I know, he passed the card on them. Fletcher Henderson. That's doggone shit. Fats wrote these numbers. I mean, I know, because I'd be with Fats when he'd write them. I'd listen to him play them, because he could make up a piece as fast as he could sit down at the piano, you know, and make it right up just like that, spontaneously. Well, he played all the time, that's why, you know. And he had these numbers. He and Fats was loaded with talent, you know. So I always thought that Fletcher made a mistake. He should have just hired Fats and kept him, that's all. Because he could have afforded it. I mean, he's making plenty of money this time. I mean, the time I'm talking about, he's coining money, you know. Had to be. But he wouldn't do it. The only thing I remember from Fletcher, I remember he hired his brother Horace. He had Horace playing the piano with him several times, you know. And most of the time, of course, Fletcher played the piano himself, you know, the band. But a few times he decided to have Horace play the piano, and he got him a baton and started directing. Of course, Horace used to play very, very good. But I thought that way back during this time when he used to have quite a bit of dealings with Fats, and Fats used to write a lot of, compose a lot of pieces for him and everything and all that, and he should have been me. I'd have hired Fats to play the piano.
Was he exciting to have in the band?
Well, you know what he was. Fats is a natural. He's just funny. He's funny to look at. He's a show within himself, you know? And I was just taking advantage of that show, that's all. Of course, I don't know. When you stop to think about it, times change, don't they? At this particular time, nobody thought about it in that way. You know? Like people that were really showmen. And nobody thought about them as being showmen. Didn't appreciate that part of it. I think that's what it was. Because this real showmanship didn't go in for real appreciation until, late 30s. That's when that started, you know. Because look at all the other times, even Fats himself. I mean, you know, he didn't go out, he wasn't out making big money until it was around the late 30s when it started, you know. Yeah, maybe that's one of the reasons. I guess he didn't think of the valuation of the showmanship. Because Fats is funny, all you had to do is sit down there and start playing and laughing. That's the show.
When Rex joined the band,
have
much effect on the band.
Well, Rex was at that time, you know, Rex was quite a showman at that time. I think Rex was more or less a showman because he had to be. I don't know. I think Rex had to do a little comedy around some of these parts he was reading. You know, like you get to some of these passages were kind of hard. He couldn't read them fast enough or something like that. Well, Rex would have to stomp his foot or do something or take his horn down and twirl it up or do something. You know what I mean? At this particular spot, you know. Because I always noticed when Rex did a little bit of his comedy, it was like you go over and look at his music and you'd see it was it'd be about 20 notes right at this place, you know what I mean?
Did he join the band right after Billy left?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right after Louis left, he was... It's funny. Rex was playing. He's playing in some club or something. I think Louis went up and spoke to him about it.
Well, Rex was quite a big figure in New York in those days, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Used to play with a mute a lot.
Well, how did Joe Smith stack up to your qualifications as a man who was a musician and all-around man?
Yeah, Joe, I tell you, actually, really, the outstanding thing about Joe was his, Joe had a good tone. And Joe used to take a plunger, used to play in a plunger a lot. And he could take a plunger, and he had very, real sweet sound, you know what I mean? And it was big enough. It was big enough, too, you know? And he had a real good tone.
When in this period in New York, when you were around so much with Fletcher's band, were there any people that you thought of as being great who have since died out and aren't particularly well known by people now?
No, I think the majority of them, known by people actually knowing them in person? Or you mean through books or people that they still write about or they don't write about? Is that it? Well, like, for instance, I know those people that have died, but they still write about them in books, like you take, like Jimmy Harrison, people like that. But, of course, there's very few people around, you know, interested in music that knew anything about him, you know, actually. Because the ones that do, they're much older people and they perhaps don't even come around anymore, you know. The ones that would perhaps know about Jimmy. There's a few musicians around that knew Jimmy, you know. Like people like Rex and them, I mean, they all know Jimmy, you know. Well, they played with him, you know. But you're speaking of just people on the outside that... Well, Jimmy, I thought, was quite a trombone player. He was more or less quite a bit on the order of Jack Teagarden, though, I think, you know. Because I never forget, it's funny. You know, I used to kid Jimmy a lot. And I used to tell him all kinds of things. Because I could tell him anything. I mean, he never got angry at me about it or nothing, you know, because we used to kid each other all the time. And I used to tell him, I said, doggone shame the way you fooling people. I said, you ain't doing nothing. I said, you're not playing your changes. You're missing changes. I said, now look at this. Look at this. You just played this. You see this change right here? This change makes this other one sound better because it resolves into the other one. You're supposed to make this one first, then make that one. But the reason you didn't make this one is because you don't know it. I said, why don't you admit it? Just like that, you know? And I'd get him in front of somebody. He'd be talking this stuff, you know? He wouldn't care. He just laughed it off, you know what I mean? He started kidding me about something, you know what I mean? Something like that, you know? So I'll never forget. The first time we ever heard Jack Teagarden, we was in Roseland. So, this other band played the first set. So, I went upstairs. I had my horn out, and I was upstairs. I'd heard about this Teagarden, you know? Because it seems as though he was in New York once before, and he didn't stay very long, and he went away. And some people that knew me had told me about it, you know. Some of the boys downtown, you know, like, I don't know, was it some of the, maybe Jimmy Darcy or somebody I knew, you know, mentioned it to me. But now, so I went up to hear him, you know, and Jimmy and all the rest of them were downstairs. Oh, I don't even know where they were in yet, you know. So I heard him playing. So I went downstairs to get Jimmy and fella to start kidding about it, you know. I said, the man is, there's a boy upstairs that played an awful lot of trombone. Yeah, who's that, Hulk? I says, this boy from New Orleans or Texas or something. I don't know, what do they call him? Jack Teagarden or something. I said, man, Did Jimmy, you know him? Oh, now, how am I going to know him? I don't know anybody. What's he play? He's a trombone player. He played like the rest of the trombones, that's all. Right? He says, I don't see no trombones. He says, trombones is a brass instrument. It should have that sound just like a trumpet. He says, I don't want to hear no trombones sound like trombones. I can't see it. I said, but Jimmy, he doesn't sound like those trombones. I said, he plays up high and making these, he sounds a whole lot like trumpets to me. He said, oh man, he says, I ain't paying that no mind. He says, I'm so I never forget. Jimmy Jack got to be the tightest of friends. After this first night, I couldn't separate Jimmy and Jack Teagarden. So we used to come up to my house practically every night. We'd come up to my house and, I don't know how they was making it, because we'd sit up there and fool around until 2 and 3 and 4 o'clock in the afternoon, no sleep. And we'd be working down there every night. And we used to sit there and drink all night and eat, these cold cuts and cheese and crackers and stuff. We'd do this and play. Playing all night. See, Jimmy and Jack both jiving each other. Both of them jiving each other. See, trying to figure out what he lacked that he could get from the other one. And the other one doing the same thing. See, and I dug it. I knew this was going on. He couldn't fool me, because I didn't get so tight so quick. You know what I mean? So, I used to have to bring them both up. But I had the piano, and they could play all night. You know what I mean? I didn't disturb anybody or nothing, you know. The house was all well-draped and carpeted, so nobody heard it. Nobody paid any mind. So both of them got the trombones, and I'm playing the piano for them. This used to go on all night long, listening to records and eating and talking, back to playing again and this. That was every night. Oh, you know, Jack. Of course, he's never changed. He's still the same. And you couldn't keep Jack out of Harlem. You couldn't keep Jack out of Harlem. He made all of these, you've heard of these, what they used to call them, these house rent parties. He made every house rent party. And you see, the funny thing about it was, at this time, these people didn't know anything about Jack Teagarden. They didn't know who this was, you know. And I've carried him around to all these places because he wanted to go, you know. And, I won't have to mention what they eat at these parties, because they have some very peculiar delicacies, the food, see. But this was right down Jack's alley. And he's crazy about this kind of food. I didn't know anything about it, but that's what he wanted. I'd be looking for him. He's out in the kitchen with these people. Got a great big plate full of this stuff that they eat. You know what I mean? And that's what he likes. Well, so it's funny, because Jack made himself right at home. And always had that horn. He used to play, I don't know how this man ever, he never slept. He was playing the horn night and day. But that was a funny experience, and that's where it came up. Because Jimmy had never heard anybody play trombone like that. We used to do this stuff all night. You know, like, say, sometimes people would like, sometimes wouldn't even start till be 4 o'clock, something like that, you know. Well, it didn't last till 8, 9, 10 o'clock in the morning. Sometimes all the way till afternoon. Once I was up Jimmy's Chicken Shack till about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We finished this thing. And he wasn't getting a quarter. Wasn't getting nothing, and he's got a packed house. Can't move in the place, these people. And if we'd have quit any minute, everybody would have walked out. And we didn't even get a free drink. Because if I ever drink I had, I paid for, unless somebody, you know, if somebody sitting at the table asked me to have a drink or something like that. But outside of that, the boss, he offered me a drink. That's why, you know, the union cut all that stuff out. The union. They don't want that foolishness no more.
What?
A person can go in and you can get away with setting in a spot like, for instance, you sure the union's not coming in or something, and like going down to Minton's where they hire musicians, where they're playing, and like a fella comes off the stand and they ask you to play something for him. That's all right, you can get away with that. But I mean, these actual places, like Jimmy had no music up there. All he had there was his piano, you know? And we just go in, sit there and play all morning piano. Because there's always two, three piano players around, like Teddy Wilson, Art Tatum, and Marlowe, and all that bunch. They were always there, you know. So we no lack for pianists. And then there was another one. Can't think of his name. They were all real good piano players. Clyde Hart, and all these people, you know. But the funny part about it to me was it used to be how these people. You'd do this in these places, and they'd get all these people. The house would be packed and jammed. And I mean, if we weren't there playing like this, there wouldn't be a soul in the place. And the boss, though, he didn't come over and offer you a drink, even. I mean, he could have at least offered you a drink, you know what I mean? And, gee, you fellas sure sound good, you know, or something, you know what I mean? And pat you on the back and give you a drink, you know what I mean? And, you know, but... But nobody cared, because everybody was enjoying themselves just playing for nothing.
Well, in the band, as it was set up, let's say, in the 20s when you were 12, you actually played lead in the sax section, didn't you?
No. Mm-mm. Don used to play lead with that band. Mm-hmm. And Don used to play lead. It might have been some things where they had the lead written for the tenor. But the majority of times, I think I was playing just the, tenor part.
Did you ever double?
Well, clarinet, and all the saxophones. Once I had a whole crowd of saxophones. I had a baritone, a bass, had a soprano, baritone, bass, soprano, and a tenor. I had me a rack and everything. That's really back those days you're talking about too. That's what it was, because I quickly got rid of all that stuff off of me.
How long were you with Fletcher?
It's been right around 10 years. You're close to it anyway, you know.
The difference in your style from the very beginning and when you left Fletcher is really remarkable. Can you account for this?
That's just like everything else. It changed automatically through different things that I heard, and it always shows in your music. I mean, it just comes spontaneously. I mean, you don't have to practice it. I never practiced anything like that, you know. I never practiced any particular thing to learn a style or anything like that. I never did in my life. I find myself playing a lot of things, changing them around and playing them completely different than what I perhaps would have played them a year before. But that just came through, I mean, different things I've heard. You know, I've heard it and I remembered it, you know what I mean? And the next night, I perhaps didn't even remember it. But maybe 6 months later, it'll show in the music I play or something. You know, like that? Well, that's what used to happen, and that's why the style used to change all the time. And I tell you something else I used to do. I was the only one. There wasn't anybody else doing this. I used to go out on these road trips with Fletcher, and that's one of the reasons why each time I came in, that's one thing I used to do. Every time we came in after a road trip, I always had me some new things. And you know where I used to find it? In these little clubs and places and all these little towns we used to go in and play, you know, because when we got through playing, I used to make all the clubs. I mean, all the places, and they all had little bands playing them in those days, you know. So I'd make them. And I'd hear somebody playing something, or I'd hear something that sounded good, because there was a lot of good musicians throughout all around the country at the time, you know, and a lot of good little bands that was playing like mad. They were, I'm talking about these small combinations now. I'm not talking about the big 16-piece bands. Now, this is just strictly combinations. They were playing like all the places, like Kansas City and St. Louis and Indianapolis and all the towns, you might say, Detroit, every place. Well, We'd come back in New York, and I'd come in, and I'd come up with this. I got some new riffs, you know. The fellas in the band, they didn't know where they didn't even know where I got them from, because they didn't hear. They never heard them. They'd be out and trying to have a ball someplace. They'd out looking for chicks and things, you know what I mean? And I mean, I was finding places where I could hear some music, because that's all I liked, you know. And that's, I used to pick up a lot of things like that, you know. And I never stopped, you know. I'm still doing the same thing right today. I hear every musical organization of any interest that there is, I hear. I don't miss nothing. Like all these clubs around here that feature jazz and all that. I go in them all the time. I go down to Bohemia, and I go to Birdland, I go to Basin Street, I go any place where there's gonna be any music's going on, I got to hear it. And the main reason I want to hear it is because I want to see what I can learn all the time, that's all.
What led up to your leaving and going to Europe?
I was out in the Midwest with Fletcher, you know, and we were traveling around and playing in different spots. And we went to Toronto and a few other places in Canada, in Montreal or someplace. And I know, but anyway, I know it was Toronto we left from and came into Buffalo. Then it took us a couple of weeks and we came back to New York. And when we came into New York, I met June Cole, bass player. He was with Fletcher once. Anyway, I met them in a bar, Big John's. Big John's one night, one of the bars we used to go in a lot. And this is right after they came back from Europe. They'd been over there for several years, you know. So I happened to mention to June, I said, June, you know, I was up in Canada. I said, Montreal is quite Frenchy. And I said, I was in Toronto, and Toronto's rather kind of British-like, you know. And I said, you know, I believe I'd like to go over to Europe. I said, how is it over there? And he started to tell me about this and that and the other and how nice it was and so forth and all. I said, you know, I think I'd like to go over to London. And he said, well, why don't you write Jack Hilton? Tell Jack Hilton you'd like to come to London. I said, well, Jack Hilton didn't know anything about me. He says, oh, are you kidding? I said, Jack Hilton got the biggest band in England. He says, those people hear about you over there, they know all about you. They were sending me those melody makers, you know, and they always had some article in the melody maker about me, you know, and all that. So I got in my car and went over right over to that 126th Street, 125th Street, was between on St. Nicholas Avenue and the Telegraph, Western Union, just like that. Just we standing there talking, just like that. I just walked out. I said, wait for me, I'll be right back. I ran over there, said a telegram, Jack Hilton, London, England. That's all I had on it. Jack Hilton, London, England. And said, I'm interested in coming to London. Signed my name, Coleman Hawkins. And I put that in my address, my home address in there, you know, and so on, so on, so on, so on, New York, and signed my name, Coleman Hawkins. And the next morning, or the next afternoon, I had a cable from Jack saying he wanted me to come over. Asked me how much money I wanted. He sent the ticket, and he told me that it would be a few days to get the permission and for me to go where I was supposed to go, the you know, the British consulate, you know, and they would have the confirmation and everything about my working permit and so forth and all that. This was all done in such a big hurry, you know. And they got the passport over by telephone. The passport was done in a matter of just a few hours, you know. They had to call it through. And I went down on the Ile de France, went to London.
Did you have to give up a job to go?
No, we weren't working steady at the time. But Fletcher was just gigging and not doing too awfully well at the time either, to go along with it, you know, because this was still the carryover from the Depression, you know, and Every now and then you'd work a job and you have a hard time seeing the money. You'd get through work and the boss couldn't be found. Things like that, you know. I told Fletcher I'd take a leave of absence, go over, and I said I'd stay over about a month or two, something like that, and I'll be back. I stayed over 6 years and came back. Fletcher, first time I went someplace, I think it was in Chicago. Fletcher was playing, and he knew I was out in the audience, you know, and he sent the waiter with a note. He's asking me, he says, have you got your saxophone with you? Don't you think it's about time the leave of absence is over? You know what I mean? And signed his name at the bottom, you know.
What kind of a job did you walk into when you got to London?
It was a funny thing, you know. I was supposed to, what Jack had in mind, he wanted to do something with Louis. And he had in mind to arrange a whole lot of concerts and things for me to do with Louis and use Louis' band, you know? But I don't think Louis had too much eyes for it. Because I saw Louis, he was playing in the some theater in London. That's when I went to the theater to see him, you know? Was backstage and was talking to him in the dressing room, and we made arrangements, said, I'm going to, he said, be down in Liverpool. I think it was Liverpool, might have been another town, but asked me, what's all right? Would I come down there and we'll have a rehearsal? So I said, sure, I'll come over. She said, no, don't make any difference. I said, I won't, what I'm going to do is going to be easy anyhow. There ain't going to be much, nothing much to rehearse. I said, so I was waiting for the time to come when I was going over to see him to rehearse. When I come to find out, it was only about 2 days. I guess it was about 2 days left, that's all. He canceled the contract, kind of canceled the concert completely. See, they didn't have a contract or nothing, neither did I. But it was easy for him to do it, you know. At the time, it didn't do him too much good at all, because Jack Hilton was big, awful big man in England. But I didn't have anything to do with it, and I wasn't. Something went wrong someplace, I know that, because it never happened. So afterwards, there wasn't anything for me to do except to just go strictly in the variety shows with Jack and Mrs. Hilton. So I used to, then all I had to do, about midway of the program each night, was come out and do my solos out in front with the band accompaniment in the back, and that's all there was to it. It was easy, you know.
6 years over there, what countries did you find most receptive to jazz?
Well.
6 years over there, what countries did you find most receptive to jazz?
Well. Let's see. At that particular time, I'd say Denmark and Holland. Right at that particular time. Yeah, I'd say they were perhaps the very tops then.
More so than France.
At that particular time, they were a little bit, yeah, France didn't have quite the interest then. But now, today, there's nothing worse than France today. Oh, they've been studying jazz. they come to the concert with books. With books and their research. They got everything. They come in there with papers and pens and everything. Oh, yes. And they can tell any musician, like they listen, and they listen very good. And the minute they hear a musician playing something that is not theirs or no type of originality to it, they see that their sounds begins to sound like them, as though they're doing a burlesque on somebody else or something like that, you know. They start to boo you. Oh yeah, they're allowed to boo you with that. Like for instance over here, you'd be on stage doing that, and the kids would be hollering and screaming and applauding and raving about it. That same thing would get you a nice boo in a sour play-off. One of the greatest ones you ever had, you get. They just boo you off the stage. You know, you didn't get off. Because, they start it, you know, and they work it up. Like, it'll get started, and pretty soon the whole place, and it's a huge place, you know what I mean? They'll just, nothing for you to do, just turn around and walk off, that's all.
Did you ever get one?
No, I've been lucky. Well, you see, I would never get one of those in France for the reason, like I'm telling you, the reason that they give it. Because that's the one thing I would stay as far away from as possible. You know what I mean? No.
Well, when you left England, did you go first to Holland and Denmark?
Let me see. When I first left England, I went to France.
Did you go
first? Old Paris. I went over with Jack Shaw and played the Gaumont Theater and the Rex Theater. Then after that, I went with Jack to Holland and played Amsterdam, Rotterdam, and The Hague. And then Jack went back to England, and I stayed on the continent.
Did you hook up with some other guys there in Paris, or did you have your own group?
Not anything particular. I used to play with everything, everybody. I played duets, I played with trios. I played with symphony orchestra. I played with
the symphony orchestra. What was this occasion?
Oh, a concert in Roubaix, France. My accompaniment was a big 100-piece symphony. That was the accompaniment for me.
What kind of material?
I played "It's the Talk of the Town" in D natural, but they played it with me. Yeah, they played all these pieces. They somebody jotted this stuff down for them, you know what I mean? The things they're supposed to play. I mean, you know, this jotted the chorus down. That's all chorus with a ending, you know what I mean? And they fixed it for me to make my little breaks and things, you know what I mean, to bring the ending in. And the director just brought them down on this long, big, heavy ending card, and that's all there was to it. And it was real funny. And I was the only thing on the program like this. I mean, like they had an opera singer. There was a, naturally, you know, at these concerts, they always have these soloists. Like they had a cello soloist that night on the program, things like that. Just imagine, now I'm on this program. And the concertiest thing there, I mean, the the long-hairedest thing I played was "It's the Talk of the Town." I didn't think I started playing violin soul until, let me see, in 39. I used to use violin soul. I used to use it quite a lot as an encore. And then I never thought of it seriously. I never thought about it in soul as being anything big for me at all. I used it as an encore, something to get off the stage with. Now, you know how much I thought of it. I call myself getting off the stage. I want to ease off. You know what I mean? It's through, you know? And I'd play this thing, you know? I never thought anything of it. Playing down at Kelly's. When Victor asked me to record it, I was surprised that they even thought about it. But what they'd done, some of the boys had come in, you know, and had heard me play it in the club. So they asked Leonard Joy to get me to make it, to record it, you know. Well, what is this? I said, I don't even have an arrangement on it. I said, that's nothing. Who wants to hear that? Well, no, Hawk said the boys are raving about it, and they're raving about it down in Camden and everything. So says, I think you should do it for them. Okay, it's all right. That's the way they want it. I said, because it isn't a big piece for me at all. I said, and I don't even have an arrangement on it. He said, well, you just play it whichever way you play it here. Just play that, that's all. So what we used to do, at night I used to play, I'd be after a couple of quarts of scotch. I'd sit down there, killing time. I'd perhaps play about 10 courses on it, and the boys, every so often, they'd come in with me and play harmony notes, you know what I mean? And then I'd finish it up, and that was all it was, you know? So naturally, when we got ready to do the date, they couldn't play but two courses because the record wouldn't, 3-minute record won't take over that, you know? So we did it the same way, and I thought nothing of it. I mean, I only made one thing on it. And, you know, they used to have a way. They'd make a test record, like the one, then they'd make two masters while they're making each test, just in case if it comes through okay, then it isn't necessary to make anymore, you know? So that's all we did. And I didn't even bother to listen to it afterwards. Got through playing it and packed my horn up and walked out. Man, I'll never forget. I was sitting up in Fat Man's, and there was a bunch of us up there at the bar. And this was very shortly after it on Martin Block's program, you know, the one that used to come on around 6:30 or something at night. This thing, huh? Yeah, something, one of those. And this thing came on, and so one of the girl was sitting there. Says to me, she says, you record Body and Soul? I said, yeah. She said, is that your record? Listen, I said, that's my tone, like, more or less, you know. I said, that's funny. This thing, it actually sounded good, you know, and I was surprised, you know. That was the best number of the date. And I mean, that's the one that I thought was nothing. I didn't figure that. That's just one of those things.
You think it's probably an accident that music is good and popular at the same time?
That has to be an accident. That's just very rare. That's something that's hard to understand. Nobody's ever made me understand that one. Thelonious Monk said that to me once. Thelonious Monk said to me, about, oh, I guess it was about the last time he ever said it. He said it quite often back in the 52nd Street days, but about 6 months ago, he mentioned to me, he says, you know, you never did explain to me, he said, how did these people, these old folks and everybody, go for your record of Body and Soul? Monk, I don't know. So, he says, I can't understand it. He says, that's one thing I'll never understand. He says, I don't see how they went for it. He said, now, because I've listened to the record. He said, now, I could understand if you played melody. He said, because that's what they like. Those kind of people, they like that. That's what they like. They like melody. He said, they sure won't listen to anything else that's jazz. He says, I can't understand how they listen to it. So I just told him, I said, that's just one of those cases. You know, that's just one of those rare cases. Because, I mean, good gracious, I mean, I play like that all the time. You know what I mean? I made 1,000 pieces of that same thing, you know what I mean? Played in the same vein and everything else. But they didn't mean nothing, you know? So it's just one of those things. It's just supposed to be that way that time. That's all. So you know I didn't play no. Where's the melody in Body and Soul? So I've told these people, you can just hear the melody all through it. Now these are the people that don't know anything about music. I mean, these are people I'm talking about. You know, the people that you got to please. You know, they hear the melody. Where's the melody? They didn't play no melody. There ain't no melody. No real melody in the whole piece. You know what I mean? That's what Monk was saying. He says, I don't understand. He said, man, he says, there's no melody in there. He said, what are they listening to? You know? I don't know. I kept on, you know, like the studios kept on telling me, well, do another one like Body and Soul. I said, another one like Body and Soul. I said, I made 100 of those. I made 100 of them just like Body and Soul. I said, it don't mean nothing. I said, don't you understand what it is? It isn't that. It just so happens that at the right time, And it just caught on with the right people, and that's all it was to it. I mean, it's just it's a lucky thing. That's what that is. That's all. It couldn't be anything else. Goodness. And they still go for it just as it is. It has to be just like that.
You've been involved in jazz in the very earliest days. You came up with Henderson. Your style changed. And jazz became more modern. You became more modern. You were probably the first person to ever record Thelonious Monk, which was
your band. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
How did you happen to get involved with the boppers, with the modern jazz?
Well, I mean, that wasn't fixed either. That was just... wherever there's good musicians, you'll always find me. That's all I've ever been used to. That's where that comes from. And you see, I don't think about music in the way that other people think about it, I guess. Like, for instance, I don't think about music as being new or modern or anything of the type. I don't think about it in that way, you know what I mean? Like, music doesn't go seasonable to me. I think it's, I don't know, you just play.
Do you recall at all when you first heard some of the, I call them modern
music? Oh, well, that was right after I came back from Europe. I heard them when I came back from Europe. I used to come up to the uptown house. Used to be one of the after hour spots around, and these fellas used to all be playing. Used to play up there every night, and I used to practically go up there regularly. I'd went someplace. I'd leave. Steve Kelly's at night, and I'd always go some of the other spots, you know. And so I'd always go to wherever the fellas are playing. That's how I met most of these people.
When you came back from Paris in 1939, did you think that the general shape the music was in this country was pretty sad, or did you see things happening, or did it look like it was...
In 1939? Well, MC, and I came back in 1939. I liked I liked Basie's band. I used to like Count's band, but the majority of soloists, I didn't think too much of the soloists. They didn't seem to be playing anything, but I liked the Basie's band as a band. I liked it had a very good rhythm, very good beat, I thought, you know, at that time. But there wasn't any soloists around that interested me. They didn't seem to be playing anything. They weren't making changes good. You know, the changes were kind of sad. And I listened. I went around. I heard all the musicians, and I used to go to all the sessions and everything. You know, I didn't notice that, but I was surprised. You know, because I'd been over there for so long. You know. And I thought by the time I came back, I thought the musicians here would be much further advanced, you know. But it was just like when I left. I hadn't seen it, nothing. Hadn't advanced it, hadn't done anything. I started playing, and a lot of them used to say I was playing wrong notes. And it used to be funny to me. I used to laugh about it. I couldn't understand that. Like the first time I played Body and Soul, you know, when the record first came out, everybody, including Chu and everybody, said I was playing wrong notes in it. It was funny to me. They just weren't making these changes in Body and Soul. It's the only changes to make in Body and Soul. That's when I couldn't understand why weren't they making them. They weren't making them. The changes I made in Body and Soul, that's the only changes to make in Body and Soul. What I mean is that is Body and Soul, actually. You know what I mean? They thought that was wrong.
Would you play it that way now?
I still do play it that way. I just play different notes, that's all. But I still play the same changes. I play all these changes all the time. I might even play a few more now. Because, I mean, you can add a few more now. You know what I mean? Now that the ear has been listening, you know. But at that time, I mean, you make some type of a D change or anything going into a D flat. That was wrong. Yeah, at that time, you had to make an A7, A-flat 7th to go into a D-flat. If you didn't make A-flat 7th, strictly A-flat 7th. Now, they don't know that that's a relative chord to D anyway, but I mean, they just didn't know these things, and they couldn't see any other way. They heard that D, it had to be, ooh, that's terrible. You know, which is nothing but a flatted 5th form and things like that. That's all an augmented change or something like that, but they couldn't hear it. I mean, of course, that's extremely common now, you know. But that just became common after that. It certainly wasn't common before I raised body and soul, I can tell you that now. No. Mm-mm.
Do you think there would have been such a thing as Bach if it hadn't been a war?
Well, they wouldn't have called it Bach, but there had to be, as far as, idea of playing, or as far as the changes that they make and the substitutions and things that go on today, that was, war had nothing to do with that.
It was bound to happen.
Well, sure. Well, I mean, that's like I'm talking about. That's just evolutions in music, but it takes them so long. Goodness. That's what they should have been playing when I came back in 39. That's what I mean, you know. When I came back, I'd have gone around and listened, you know what I mean? And I would have said, boys are getting smart, just like that, you know? But when I come back, I didn't hear a thing. It made it very easy for me, too. Boy, did it make it easy. You know, it was funny to me. That's what I always had a big laugh about that, you know? You know, when I came back, you know, they were laying for me. I can tell you, though, they figured I'd been in Europe so long, you know, now this was a real chance to catch me. Because I tell you, they've been wanting to catch me. They tried to catch me ever since I've been a kid. I don't know why they never did leave me alone. They never did leave me alone. They got to cut me, if possible, and all that, you know. So they had this famous place up here on 130th and St. Nicholas Avenue. Well, boy, they was waiting. So I used to go around, I'd go in there, I used to hear, I heard everything I was going to hear in there. I said, man, to myself, they're not going to cut me playing that. Not just what I just got through listening to. I mean, there must be something they're holding back. I know what this is. they're just waiting for me, you know what I mean? You know, they think I'm staying up or something, I've been away too long and all that, you know, but I think, if that's the best they're going to play, they're not like that, they won't, you know. So, that was the funniest thing. So I said, well, it'd be easy. It'd be easy to play with that. I mean, that ain't going to be too much strain at all to play with this, you know, because all you got to do is make a couple of off notes here. Make a couple of off notes and you got it made. I knew that because they never made any, you know. Goodness. Don Bias is a good saxophone player. Don Bias, I don't know. Don, I think, is a little bit too French now. I don't think Don will ever come back here now. Yeah, he's a little bit too French. He got away from it. You never did hear that band I had when I was using the two tenors, huh? I had Don. Just the two tenors and the trumpet and the three rhythm. We had a good little band. It was well rehearsed. We used to rehearse every day. Hadn't played nothing but arrangements. Everything we played was all written down outside of the various solos themselves. All the rest of it was all written.
Who's that trumpet?
Had a little boy that a few years before was an excellent little trumpet player. Little Benny.
Benny Harris.
Little Benny Harris. Yeah, Benny Harris. But Benny kind of lost his lip a little bit, and he wasn't so perfect, you know. At this time, like in other words, I mean, he'd fluff a few notes every now and then, things like that, you know. His lip wasn't as good as it has been. Once upon a time, he had a very good lip, you know. And I was surprised. I couldn't understand how he'd lost his lip in being young, too, you know what I mean? Because he was playing like mad when he was 16 years old. Because he was playing like mad when he was 16 years old. He was out here playing like some of us.
You know, did you go to Charlie Parker before you went?
Yeah. Charlie was out in Kansas City. See, I knew Charlie from Kansas City a long time ago.
Did he strike you as a man who might cause a revolution someday?
Uh-huh. I knew he was a good saxophone player. Yeah, he's been playing saxophone. I've been playing saxophone a long time.
What'd you think?
And he always played just like that.
What'd you think? Well, he always played like
that. Sure, he's always played like he played. You know, quite similar to it anyway, but he used to specialize in blues. You know, he's one of the best blues players you ever heard. That's what I used to admire Charlie playing. He can play some blues. He got all kinds of blues he can play. You never have heard anything about the New York sound. Never has been. I don't know. It's a funny thing how they've always kept the any originality from jazz away from New York. I don't know why either, because this place makes all musicians sound funny when they come around. When they first come here, I don't care what they were in their hometowns. When they come here, they get cut. They get cut every time. They have to come here and learn all over again, practically. Then when they come back, they're all right. Or if they stay here, they'll develop to be all right. But I don't know why. And they sound fine out west. You hear, like you go out in these little towns out there, you know, and you'll hear the band, you'll say, man, you guys sound good, you know. That's why I was always skeptical. I never did either. I've never brought any Western bands or any bands I had out someplace else and brought them into New York. Never will. Remember when Basie first came here? Basie first came here, the band he first brought here, nobody's seen since. He disappeared. He must be picking up, firing so fast it was up to the Savoy, you know, and all that. And John Hammond was fooling around with him. The first thing I knew, they had Dickie Wells. They get all these different boys, these Eastern boys that pick it up. You know what I mean? And they look the bassist band. And I think, well, it's the Kansas City people. There ain't nobody in here but you. But he says, they came in and they opened up the Savoy. And man, and we was nothing. The people would come in and say, what is that? And turn around and walk out. But because he said, I'd have given up. That's how he said. You know, he said, but John Hammond and this and that, you know what I mean, was talking to us and doing this and that and that and telling us about, well, we'd go out for a while and come back and make some changes and all this, you know what I mean? I said, well, what'd you go in there for in the first place? He said, well, John, come on, man, heard the nine pieces and thought we was the greatest thing in the world. He said, I believed it. He said, I believed it, and we came in. I know what it is. That's the thing I told you about. Then I can give you a good example right now of something that happened in the past year, a certain boy. And you know him. You know this Cannonball? I heard Cannonball 2 years ago, or a little better than 2 years ago. That's when I was down to Miami Birdland, you know, in Miami. Cannonball used to come in and play. And Cannonball, I thought Cannonball sounded good. And this kid is going. Why don't you go to New York? You're wasting your time playing all that much horn blowing down here. He came up last summer. I don't know whether you heard him or not. He was down to Bohemia. All the boys went in, listened to him. That's Cannonball? That's the way he plays? Let me go get my horn. Boys coming to going out, getting their horns, and coming back and blowing, and he was talking about being too bad, man. That's a nice fella. And everybody comes talking about, well, his brother's not bad. His brother plays a nice trumpet, but man, he ain't doing nothing, man. I don't hear nothing. Good gracious, everybody's doing anybody do that. Well, Cannonball left. He came back. Have you heard him this last since he's been back? He can play now. Oh, yeah, he can play now. He can play for New York now. Because he's blowing that horn now, really. But it's like what I said, it never fails. I've never seen it fail.
Well, since the audience is in New York, musicians, that's what they
kind of say. Oh, sure. Well, it is, because the audience don't know. The audience don't know anything. See, you can take you can break it up with the audience, and the audience will think you're the greatest thing it ever was, just any kind of hit, a little trick. Jacket did it with hitting the one note. And I know other fellas did put the knee up in the bell and made an A. Flattened out that B-flat, flattened the B-flat into an A, and people in the house thought it was the greatest thing they ever heard. Yeah, he put his knee up on the bell. Don't you realize that? I mean, that's a big deal. I mean, you can't go to the audience. You got to please the musicians, though. I don't know what it is about them. You got to please them.
What do you think is in store for us in the next 5 to 10 years in jazz?
Well, I think eventually that ballads will start coming back. I think the ballad movement will come back again not too long from now. And, I think the noise and the sounds and the rock and roll eventually will get, it'll eventually get tiresome and it'll fade out eventually, you know, like that. I'm not going to say that rock and roll won't always be here, because it will. I mean, nobody's no use nobody ever saying it won't, because it's here to stay, don't worry. But, I mean, as being the thing, no, it won't be the thing, no. No.
Well, how about things growing out of, let's say, the Mulligan, Brubeck?
Well, I think that's as big as it'll get. No further for that to go.
Do you think it's going to end eventually on individuals? I mean, as much as it always has on brilliant soloists and actually people who are great creative artists by themselves, or people who write?
Well, I don't know. I think eventually that it'll go back to both. You know, I think it'll have to be people who write and the artists themselves too, and all that, to create the interest, you know. Then of course the proper rhythm sections.
Do you think good things can come out of some of the things that happen now, like mixing in French horns and oboes and flutes and so on?
Oh, I think that's marvelous. Mm-hmm. Oh, I think that's the ideal. That's the kind of band. Yeah. Good gracious. In every effect in the world you want. About 11 brass. Look down here, you got 2-3 cellos over here, and here's some great big-sized violins, what they call violas, and then over here's your violins, and a couple flute players over here, and woodwinds and all that. I mean, that's it, you know. Especially with this 11 brass. 11 brass and the great big tuba player back there and all that. That's the kind of band to have, but what you gonna do with them? Get together and starve to death. Because that's all you can do with them. Starve to death. Everybody's gonna starve. Can't make it. Matter of fact, because I very, very seldom will go out on a, you know, go out of town on a, any kind of a tour, like, it might be just a one-nighter, and I'm not doing those things anymore. I quit them. Not that I wouldn't, I'd go out for a week or so, you know what I mean? if it paid well enough. If it didn't, I wouldn't. Because I keep, like, for instance, you keep busy right around New York. You don't have to go no place. No, it isn't that. It's just, it's more than likely you go to another town and 2 days you're sick of it anyway. But knowing you got to be another 5 days there and where your money's going when you get through anyway, time you get through paying double expenses, commissions, transportations, taxes, and so forth, and you get through, and you come home, what have you got? Nothing. And you say to yourself, no, I've been away from home for a week, and what have I got? I mean, what's this? I could have done a gig over in Jersey City last week and had more than this, you know what I mean? You say, well, it doesn't make sense, you know? So that's what made me get very disinterested in doing it. The last thing I was out on, I was out to... I was out to Cleveland for 10 days. I was out there just past winter in Cleveland. That's the last. I haven't been out since. And since then, I mean, I've been on gobs of gigs, and that's all. I mean, you know, we're going to Newburgh, New York, play fair, get in the car afterwards, come right back in town. I'm in town. The bars are still open. I'm setting up the bar after drink. The job's over. And I did all the proms this past this season that's getting over. I guess I've been in practically all the big hotels. And the Biltmore, the Commodore, and all that, you know. I do those things with five pieces. Well, five pieces myself. I have five men to pay. Get as much money as these great big 20-piece bands. Sick of the traveling. I mean, why bother with traveling? What do I need with 20 pieces? Basie said to me the other night, is that he's still out here scuffling with this jive man? How do you make it? I said, good gracious. I said, I don't understand it. After all these years, and you're out here scuffling, he says, the man, look, I don't want no whole lot of band either. He says, if I played that kind of piano well enough that I didn't need it, if I was one of you instrumentalists, he says, I wouldn't do it either. I wouldn't be doing it either. I'd let somebody else have those headaches and just go on by myself. I'd do that too. He says, but he said, you see, I got to have these pieces. I kid, because you know, I kid Basie all the time. We've been kidding each other ever since I've known him.
What do you think of rock and roll?
Rock and roll? Well, I think rock and roll could be it could be they could put some little embellishments around it. It could sound a little better than what it sounded, I think. You know what I mean? I don't think it has to sound bad. But the majority of towns out of times they actually make it sound bad. I don't think the right people have played it yet. See, when I was a kid, rock and roll used to sound awful good.
What was rock and roll used
to? I guess they would call it, what was it called, a gut bucket? Shout music, stomping, or something like that. It would have to be one of those, you know. I know they were playing it. So, like I say, I mean, as far as these drummers, the two clubs hammering the afterbeat, I think it had a more musical sound.
Now how was it different?
Well, it had better sounds. The The instruments used to sound better playing it or something, or playing with it or something. I don't know. But you know, honestly, but these fellas, what were this other kind of music? These fellas cannot understand this other kind of music. I have tried my best. I have even talked to them about it and everything. I even joked to them about it and things like that, and tell them that. And I said, you know, I told them, I said, I've been thinking about maybe getting me one of these real good afterbeat drummers, and get the right kind of two-string guitar player. I said, I don't even want a four-string one. I don't want a four-string one. And six-string one is out. I want a two-string guitar player, and preferably one that uses one of those oversized matchboxes as a guitar, if I could get one of those, and have me this real McCoy. And, well, they talked to me in such a way, are you serious about that, Dean? Certainly I'm serious. I mean, after all, it's making money. I might as well make some money from the thing. Good gracious. I mean, it must be. I mean, if all these crowds of people think it's great, it must be great. I must be the wrong. If I don't like it, I've got to be wrong. That's all. Now, I'm talking to them real seriously. I'm trying to feel these fellas out, you know. They have no eyes for it at all. I mean, they won't come in with me at all. I mean, they come into gradually pulling away. I mean, they think I must have gone crazy or something. What could I be thinking about, you know? I think to myself, I said, well, they're not going for it. They'd rather go barefooted. There's no question about it. They mean that. They're not kidding. They'd actually rather go barefooted. Everything before they'll do it. They're not going to do it. Well, as a matter of fact, I don't think they can do it. They don't feel it. Because I don't believe you can play that stuff without feeling it. So that's got another kind of sound to it, you know? And things the kids were saying, they said, they guess Basie's band's all right, but it's nothing for them because it doesn't have any beat. Because he's using the conventional drum beat. Choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-choo. Well, that's the convention. They don't want that. They want boom, 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 boom. That's all they want. They want that. That's strictly what it is. And you see, they don't know music. They don't know music well enough. And the minute they miss, like if the drummer is not doing that, what's this? Oh, this ain't nothing. That's the way they talk, too. They tell you real quick, this ain't nothing. What? There's no happenings here. What's that? These cats ain't got no beat. That's the way they talk. I've done it purposely. Done it purposely just to see the reaction. I do it quite often right down here to Charles's. I do it. I turn around and ask the drummer. I say, look, man, just do me a favor. Would you play me this heavy, real heavy afterbeat? That's all I want to hear. Just put the 1 and 3 on the bass drum and give me the 2 and 4 heavy on your snare drum. And then I'll get on a note or something like that and come to playing a certain thing, and here they come. Here's my crowd. I guarantee I got my crowd within a minute. Within 1 minute, I can't get out. And then if I do that a couple of courses, then everything goes back to the straight old 4 beats on the bass and all that. You know where they go for you? But it's just... Find yourself all, you're all alone again, you know, because you lost that beat.